Shabbat Shalom, and welcome back to the Way of Truth through Torah. And we are fixing to dive in to the first book of Adam and Eve, and we're starting with chapter 46, and we're going to go through 55. And we're so glad y'all can make it up the steps after eating such a huge, gigantic meal. You snooze. Well, our motto here is you snooze, you lose, okay?
Shoot, you stole my picture.
No, it's okay.
I think you leave.
I'm sorry. We've got after-lunch battles going on here. And there's, it's like musical chairs, switching, swatching. Okay, are y'all ready? Is everybody ready to start? Are y'all sure? Yep. Kids, you three of you. Do y'all want to go outside? Look at Tiffany. She's like, I didn't have anything to do with it. You're Moses, okay? You're like Moses. When Aaron and Miriam were in trouble, okay? You were the innocent bystander. Okay, are y'all ready? Here we go. Live streamers, welcome. We've got one person. Welcome, welcome. I'm glad to have anybody on board with us. Let's pray before we get started. Abba Yah, we just want to thank you so much for this day, this precious day that is set aside each week to spend with you. Mm-hmm. Father, thank you for the beautiful food that was brought today, everyone that brought it. It was wonderful. It was refreshing in the fellowship we have. Father, thank you for every bit of it. Abba, you just bless us. I almost feel like sometimes we're in the millennial because you overflow the blessings to us. And we thank you. Father, let our ears be open, our eyes attentive, and our hearts open as we're reading the first book of Adam and Eve today. Because, Father, there are so many little nuggets throughout this book. Let everyone just be so totally wrapped up in this story that we find secrets that are hidden that I haven't seen. And that Valerie hadn't seen. And that we just want to see the fullness of your word. And we see that the prophecy of our Savior's burial is in this story. There is so much revealed. So, Father, let us dive in together, and as iron sharpening iron, let us go from it. Be in this study, Father. Let nothing come out of our mouth that is not from you. We praise you. We worship you today in the precious name of our Savior, Yahusha Amashiach. We pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And here we go. Oh, guys, I didn't even push the button. Look. It's one of those days. Those? Did I not get you a book? I did. I didn't get any in.
That's all you can do.
Oh, I've got to order those. Bonnie.
Yes, ma'am.
Would you remind me after we finish today?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, because today's Shabbat, so I can't order today. So she's going to remind me, and so I'll order tonight after sunset. Okay? Everybody ready? Here we go. We're starting in chapter 46, and what happened last week?
They died.
They died.
Again.
They died. They cried. Okay, but what did Yahuwah tell them last week? In chapter 45, verse 10, he said, "Then you will see the burning of his fire that will be burning around you, and likewise your descendants. But you will not be delivered from it until my coming." Just like you cannot go into your cave right now because of the great fire around it. Not until my word comes and makes a way for you on the day my covenant is fulfilled. Who is the word of Yah?
Yahusha.
Yah goes on to say, there is no way for you at present to come from this life to rest, not until my word comes. Who is my word? Who is my word? Well, and he's not really he's not really asking a question. He's making a statement. Mm-hmm. Not until my word comes, who is my word? And who is his word is Yahusha, which is his word. So we're seeing this is just right out after the booting out of the garden, excuse me. Charles, don't do that again. You're yawning, and I'm like, oh, out I'm going to go. This is right after they've been booted from the garden. And guys, listen, already he's withdrawn himself, and the only one that's dealing with these sinful people is his word. And it's his word that he sends every single time that they're needing to be revived or comforted or rescued. And that is a lot. We're only in day, I think, about 53, and he keeps having to send and help them. Okay, so he says, until my word comes, and then Elohim called with his word to the fire that burned around the cave, that it split itself in half until Adam had gone through it. And then the fire parted itself by Elohim's order and made a way for Adam, and Elohim withdrew his word from Adam. So we see there, this is Yahusha. 46:1. Then Adam and Hua began again to come into the cave. And when they came to the way between the fire, Satan blew into the fire like a whirlwind. He's a rascal, isn't he? Just stirring up trouble. He is so jealous of the image of Yah that Yah created, that here he is. He sees fire, Adam's walking past it, and he blows on the fire and caused the burning coal fire to cover Adam and Hua so that their bodies were singed, and the coal fire scorched them. And from the burning of the fire, Adam and Hua screamed and said, "Oh Yahweh, save us. Leave us not to be consumed and plagued by this burning fire, neither require us for having transgressed your commandment." Guys, they're still pleading to get back into the garden. They're pleading for forgiveness, and they're like, "Please don't punish us anymore." Then Elohim looked at their bodies, on which Satan had caused the fire to burn, and Elohim sent his angel that stayed the burning fire. But the wounds remained on their bodies. And Elohim said to Adam, "Do you see Satan's love for you? Look how much he loves you. He just burned you. He who pretended to give you Elohim and greatness, and behold, he burns you with fire and seeks to destroy you from off the earth. Yet for him," and this is not in the book, "but for him, Adam and Hua transgressed Yah's only commandment." Because what? What was the promise? It wasn't that this fruit looked so good that they just had to have it. They would become a god. Just like Yah. They would be just like Yah. They would be mighty and powerful. And they wouldn't have to be subservient to anyone. This is what Hasatan promised him. But he loves you this much. That's how much he was going to fulfill his promise, right? Verse 5, "Then look at me, O Adam, I created you. And how many times have I delivered you out of his hand? If not, would not he have destroyed you?" Elohim said again to Hua, What is that he promised you in the garden, saying, "As soon as you eat from the tree, your eyes will be open, and you shall become like Elohim, knowing good and evil. But look, he has burnt your bodies with fire and has made you taste the taste of fire. For the taste of the garden, he's made you taste of fire for the taste of the garden." So you exchanged it. Instead of tasting of the garden, you're tasting of fire. "And has made you see the burning of the fire and the evil of it and the power it has over you. Your eyes have seen the good he has taken from you. And in truth, he has opened your eyes, and you have seen the garden in which you were with me. And you have also seen the evil that has come over you from Satan. But as to Elohim, he cannot give it to you, neither fulfill his speech to you." So as for you being a god, he can't do this. He can't even fulfill what he promised you at all. He's not capable. "No, he was bitter against you and your descendants that will come after you. And Elohim withdrew his word from them." He's defining here a huge difference between himself and Satan. Yah has taken care of him. He has delivered him. He has saved him. He has brought him back to life many times. What has Hasatan done? He's the one that Yah's been saving him from. And he's like, "Do you see this now? All that he promised you? See how much he loves you? He tried to burn you. And if it hadn't been for the angel, they probably would have burned right up." 47:1. "Then Adam and Hua came into the cave, yet trembling at the fire that had scorched their bodies. So Adam said to Hua, 'Look, The fire has burned our flesh in this world, but how will it be when we're dead? And Satan shall punish our souls. Is not our deliverance long and far off? Unless Elohim come and in mercy to us fulfill his promise. Then Adam and Hua passed into the cave, blessing themselves for coming into it once more. Where before they're like, I don't want to go in that cave. I don't want, it's dark and it's cold and I can't see you. Now they're like, bless us that we got to come into the cave. So now they're blessing it. For it was in their thoughts that they should never enter it. And when they saw the fire about it, so they thought they would never get back in. But as the sun was setting, the fire was still burning and nearing Adam and Hua in the cave, so that they could not sleep in it. After the sun had set, they went out of it. So they got up and they left the cave. This was the 47th day after they came out of the garden. They've learned a lot, haven't they? Adam and Hua then came under the top of the hill by the garden to sleep, as they were accustomed. And they stood and prayed to Elohim to forgive them from their sins, and then fell asleep under the summit of the mountain. But Satan, the hater of all good, what a good description of him, thought within himself, whereas Elohim has promised Yeshua to Adam by covenant. So what does Yeshua mean? Salvation. Whereas Elohim has promised salvation, or Yeshua, to Adam by covenant, and that he would deliver him out of all the hardships that have befallen him, but has not promised me by covenant, and will not deliver me out of my hardships. No, since he has promised him that he should make him and his descendants live in his kingdom, in which I once was, I will kill Adam. And the earth shall be rid of him, and shall be left to me alone, so that when he is dead, he may not have any descendants left to inherit the kingdom that shall remain my own realm. Elohim will then be wanting me, and he will restore it to me and my host. He sounds like a jealous girlfriend or a jealous boyfriend, doesn't he? I'm going to get rid of all the other suitors, then you're only going to have me, and you're going to love me. And he sounds kind of psychotic, doesn't he? A little. Well, he's wanting to kill him. He's the jealous son. And what he wants to be is the only son. He wants to be the only one left. 48:1. And this is the fifth apparition of Satan to Adam and Hua. If I forget to read the titles, please throw something at me. Small, please. Make it small. After this, Satan called to his host, all of which came to him, and said to him, Oh, our Lord, what will you do? He then said to them, You know that this Adam, whom Elohim created out of the dust, is the one who has taken our kingdom. Come, let us gather together and kill him, or hurl a rock at him and at Hua and crush them under it. When Satan's host heard these words, they came to the part of the mountain where Adam and Hua were asleep. And then Satan and his host took a huge rock. It was broad and even, so it was flat. It was without blemish, and thinking within himself, if there should be a hole in the rock when it fell on them, the hole in the rock might come over them so that they would escape and not die. He then said to his host, Take up this stone and throw it flat on them so that it does not roll off of them to somewhere else. And when you have hurled it, get away from there quickly. And they did as he told them, but as the rock fell down from the mountain toward Hua and Adam, Elohim commanded the rock to become a dome over them that did them no harm. And so it was by Elohim's order. But when the rock fell, the whole earth quaked with it and was shaken from the size of the rock. And as it quaked and shook, Adam and Hua awoke from sleep and found themselves under a dome of rock. But they didn't know what had happened, because when they fell asleep, they were under the sky and not under a dome. And when they saw it, they were afraid. And then Adam said to Hua, Wherefore has the mountain bent itself and the earth quaked and shaken on our account? And why has this rock spread itself over us like a tent? Does Elohim intend to plague us and shut us up in this prison? Or will he close the earth over us? He is angry with us for our having come out of the cave without his order, and for our having done so of our own accord, without consulting him, when we left the cave and came to this place. Then Hua said, If indeed the earth quaked for our sake, and this rock forms a tent over us because of our transgressions, then we will be sorry, O Adam, because our punishment will be long. But get up and pray to Elohim to let us know concerning this and what this rock is that is spread over us like a tent. Then Adam stood up and prayed before Hua to let him know what had brought about this difficult time. And Adam stood praying like that until morning. You know, this is so much like when Balaam called down, he was asking Balak to call down a curse on Israel. Remember, he was like, oh, you can't see them well enough from this mountain. Let's go to that other peak, because you'll see them, and you will definitely curse them. But every time Balak opened his mouth, what did he do? He blessed them. Every time. So what Satan intended to kill them, what happened? They were blessed. They don't know it. Because sometimes when we're blessed, we don't see the blessing. We see it as, oh no, I'm being punished. We don't see the long-term effect of it. Okay, the first prophecy of the resurrection, and this is one thing that we did put on our live stream, 49. Then the word of Elohim came and said, oh Adam, who counseled you when you came out of the cave to come to this place? And Adam said to Elohim, oh Yahuwah, we came to this place because of the heat of the fire that came over us in the cave. Then Yahuwah Elohim said to Adam, oh Adam, you dread the heat or fire for one night, but how will it be when you live in Sheol? That's scary, isn't it? Mm-hmm. But Sheol is actually the grave, right? It's just a grave. But he's basically saying here, it's going to be hot. Yet, oh Adam, do not be afraid and do not believe that I have come. That I have placed this dome of rock over you to plague you with it. It came from Satan, who has promised you Elohim and majesty. He's like, remember the guy that promised you if you eat from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that you would become like me, like Yah? You remember that guy? He is the one who put this rock over you. Satan, who promised you Elohim, he promised you power and glory. It is he who threw down this rock to kill you under it, and Hua with you, and thus to prevent you from living on the earth. But in mercy for you, just as that rock was falling down on you, I commanded it to form a dome over you and the rock under you to lower itself. And this sign, O Adam, will happen to me. Listen to this, guys. This sign, O Adam, will happen to me at my coming on earth. Satan will raise the people of the Yahudim to put me to death, and they will lay me in a rock and seal a large stone over me, and I shall remain within that rock 3 days and three nights. But on the third day, I shall rise again, and it shall be salvation, Yeshua, to you, O Adam, and to your descendants, to believe in me. But, O Adam, I will not bring you from under this rock until 3 days and three nights have passed. And Elohim withdrew his word from Adam. But Adam and Hua lived under the rock 3 days and three nights, as Elohim had told them. And Elohim did so to them because they had left their cave and had come to this same place without Elohim's order. You know, guys, when we make choices, and we make wrong choices without discussing it with Yah, there's consequences. So instead of Yah just yanking them back out from under the rock, he's like, you're going to stay here 3 days, three nights. But after 3 days and three nights, Elohim created an opening in the dome of the rock and allowed them to get out from under it. Their flesh was dried up, and their eyes and their hearts were troubled from crying and sorrow. You know, this is such a sad picture of the state that they found themselves in. We have to remember, 47, almost 50 days prior to this, they're living in the Garden of Eden. No worries, no heat, no cold, no sickness, no tears. I mean, these are tears that they're crying. They had their tears before they hit the earth. I'm seeing a lot of sleepy people around here. I'm going to ring a really loud bell and wake everyone. If I fall asleep, I'm going to scare you all. Okay, we're in chapter 50. Adam and Hua seek to cover their nakedness. Guys, did y'all see the prophecy here? Yes. Of the resurrection? Yeah. And it's just like in Matthew 12:39. We can go there and read it, but y'all have all read it before. I think that Bonnie's going to go and read it. No, she's not. Okay. Chapter 50. Oh, what was I thinking? Bonnie Jane's not going to do that. Bonnie Sue would have, though. Okay, Then Adam and Hua went forth and came into the cave of treasures, and they stood praying in it the whole of that night. A whole of that day until the evening. And this took place at the end of the 50 days after they had left the garden. Guys, before they left the Garden of Eden, that's all they did was praise and worship Yah. All of their days were spent communing with Him. How beautiful was that? And now, they're still wanting to do that.
It was the place that they were in.
It's where they felt comfort.
Exactly.
It's where they
felt care of. And,
yes.
They didn't know it because they were in Him.
Guys,
that's where we're supposed to be.
Okay, and so look where we are, because thank you, Adam and Eve, right? Where are we? We're struggling to make a living. Get up at the crack of dawn. Work till the sun goes down. Every day except what? Today.
Mm-hmm.
Today we don't have to do that. And the festival sounds. But this is where we are because of them, and we're living in, we're in Egypt. But Adam and Hua rose again and prayed to Elohim in the cave the whole of that night and begged for mercy from him. And when the day dawned, Adam said to Hua, "Come, let us go and do some work for our bodies." So they went out of the cave and came to the northern border of the garden, and they looked for something to cover their bodies with, but they found nothing and knew not how to do the work. Yet their bodies were stained, and they were speechless from cold and heat. Then Adam stood and asked Elohim to show him something with which to cover their bodies. And then came the word of Elohim and said to him, "Oh, Adam, take Hua and come to the seashore where you fasted before, where you will find skins of sheep that were left after lions ate the carcasses. Take them and make garments for yourselves and clothe yourselves with them." Okay, this is one of those verses that I've got a huge question mark by. Because there was no meat eating, right? Until after the flood and Noah landed. So even...
It was permissible because, I mean, everything, there was bone bushes, there was carnivores, there was everything after the fall of man. I mean, so animals started eating animals after the fall of man.
Okay.
But they made a garment out of a cadaver.
And that's what you're going to see. Adam has a real issue with it, but there's nothing else to make it out of. It's not a fabric shop down the road. He can't say, "Come on, go down the road to Hancock's." Well, he's got a Adam's got a problem with this, and he's fixing to talk about it. What is his beauty that you should have followed him? That's what this chapter is about. It's 51. When Adam heard these words from Elohim, he took Hua and went from the northern end of the garden to the south of it, by the river of water where they had once fasted. But as they were going on their way, and before they got there, Satan, the wicked one, had heard the word of Elohim communing with Adam, respecting his covering. And it grieved him, and he hastened to the place where the sheepskins were, with the intention of taking them and throwing them into the sea, or of burning them with fire so that Adam and Hua would not find them. Again, he's such a little rascal, isn't he? But as he was about to take them, the word of Elohim came from heaven and bound him by the side of those skins until Adam and Hua came near him. But as they got closer to him, they were afraid of him and of his hideous look. And then came the word of Elohim to Adam and Hua and said to them, "This is he who was hidden in the serpent and who deceived you and stripped you of the garment of light and glory in which you were. This is he who promised you majesty and divinity. Where then is the beauty that was on him? Where is his divinity? Where is his light? Where is the glory that rested on him? Now his figure is hideous. He has become abominable among angels, and he has come to be called Satan." Wow. They're scared of him. He's so hideous, they're afraid of him. Now the animal that he had clothed himself with, the serpent, what was it said of him? It was the most beautiful of all the creatures in the garden. He was the most beautiful. Some people say he could have been a phoenix, maybe a fire. A feathered serpent. Could have been, like Quetzalcoatl.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's lots of guesses as to what he was, but we know that he lost his arms and legs. Now he's a serpent crawling about on the ground. But do you see what he's asking him? He said, look at this. Everything that you lost, and look at him.
But he's saying that he hid behind a serpent.
Yeah, listen, the serpent allowed it because the serpent was punished. He had to crawl on his belly and lap up the dust. So the serpent was punished because he allowed it. Okay? So, and at that time, the serpent could talk and all the animals could talk. So, but he said, you know, he was beautiful when he came to you. He was beautiful.
He was talking about two different things. He was talking about Satan and he was talking about the serpent. Or are they the one that was Satan?
This is not the serpent. They're seeing Satan right now. And the serpent was not Satan. The serpent was, he was the most beautiful creature in the garden that Hasatan hid himself in. Because Hasatan is hideous.
So he possessed the serpent.
Mm-hmm. You know what? Let's look at this right now. Go to Isaiah 14:16. That's it. Jerome, hurry. I got to hurry because I got some fast people in this class.
No,
everybody's.
I'll meet y'all there.
Oh!
Yeah.
Well, let us all catch up with you, okay?
I got to Isaiah, but I don't know where to go from there.
14. Isaiah 14:16. Okay, Jerome, you will read it.
Those who see you stare at you.
Wait. Start at 12. 14:12.
How you have fallen from the heavens, O Herod, son of the morning. You have been cut down to the ground. You who lay low the nations, you have said in your heart, let me go up to the heavens. Let me raise my throne above the stars of hell. Let me sit in the mount of appointment on the side of the north. Let me go up above the heights of the clouds. Let me be like the Most High. But you are brought down to Sheol, to the sides of the pit.
Mm-hmm.
Those who see you stare at you and wonder over you, saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook rains?
Keep going.
Who made the world as a wilderness and destroyed its cities, who will not open the house of its prisoners?
Okay, so do you hear what Isaiah is saying? And he's speaking of Hasatan. He's saying, when the end comes, we're going to look on him, the one who has fallen from the heavens, son of the morning, who laid low the nations. We're going to look on him, and we're going to go, that's the Satan? That's the one who caused all these problems? Who is able to tempt us with sin? We're going to look on him and we're going to be shocked. Okay, so I'm going to start at 7. Now his figure is hideous. He has become abominable among angels. He has come to be called Satan. Oh, Adam, he wished to take from you this earthly garment of sheepskins and to destroy it and not let you be covered with it. What then is his beauty that you should have followed him? He's like, look at him. He's so hideous that you wouldn't even go close to the sheepskins because you were fearful. And what have you gained by obeying him? See his evil works and then look at me. So let's hit the little red button, right? It's the red pill or the green pill? And you hit the red pill, right? Got it. Okay. See, I bound him until you came and saw him and beheld his weaknesses, that no power is left with him, and Elohim released him from his bonds. Guys, he has no power. Listen, he isn't that creative. He has to imitate Yah and twist it, right? I'm just saying. Adam and Hua saw the first shirt. They sewed the first shirt. That cornbread and beans has affected my eyesight. I don't know. I think it was the pepper in those beans, Maria. After this, Adam and Hua said no more, but cried before Elohim on account of their creation and of their bodies that required an earthly covering. Listen, and Jerome, this is where you were coming from. Then Adam said to Hua, O Hua, this is the skin of beasts with which we shall be covered, but when we put it on, behold, we shall be wearing a token of death on our bodies. Just as the owner of these skins have died and have wasted away, so also shall we die and waste away. So he is realizing that animals had to die for those skins to be even available. And he's like, we're going to die just like them because we are beasts now.
Are these the skins that Nimrod later on stole?
It could be. It could be, because these are going to be shown by angels. We'll see. Maybe you'll say something about it. I don't think it does, though. Then Adam and Hua took the skins and went back to the cave of treasures. And when in it, they stood and they prayed as they were accustomed. And they thought, how could they make garments of these skins? For they had no skill for it. Listen, guys, they had no skill, right? They didn't know how to do anything. They had just learned to walk. They're like a 50-day-old baby. They're over 500 years old because they didn't make it a full day. And that was something I was reading earlier this morning. Adam didn't even live a full day. He was 30 years short of a day. 970 years that he lived.
So they begot, was it Cain, when they were 300 something years old or something?
I'm not sure. I'll have to look at it. No, because they were 500. They were 500 years old when they were escorted out of the garden. Okay. And they thought how they could make garments of these skins, for they had no skill for it. And then Elohim sent to them his angel to show them how to work it out. And the angel said to Adam, go forth and bring some palm thorns. And then Adam went out and brought some as the angel had commanded him. And then the angel began before them to work out the skins after the manner of one who prepares a shirt. Now, I don't know how they would know that, but they're preparing a shirt like they would do to prepare a shirt. And he took the thorns and stuck them into the skins before their eyes. And then the angel again stood up and prayed to Elohim that the thorns in the skins which should be hidden, so as to be, as it were, sewn with one thread. And so it was. By Elohim's order, they became garments for Adam and Hua, and he clothed them therewith. From that time, the nakedness of their bodies was covered from the sight of each other's eyes. So no longer did they have to look on each other's stained bodies. That's what they were saying before, right? And this happened at the end of the 51st day. Then when Adam and Hua's bodies were covered, they stood and prayed and sought mercy of Yahweh and forgiveness and gave him thanks for all that he had mercy on them and had covered their nakedness. And they ceased not from prayer the whole of that night. Then when the morning dawned at the rising of the sun, they said their prayers after their custom and then went out of the cave. And Adam said to Hua, since we do not know what there is to the west of this cave, let us go out and see it today. And then they came forth and went toward the western border. They're just like exploring, aren't they? Where are we going to go today? What's out there? They don't know. Okay, the prophecy of the western lands and the great flood. 53:1. They were not very far from the cave when Satan came towards them and hid himself. I tell you what, Bauer, you want to read from 50, just read all of 53. Can you read the whole chapter?
They were not very far from the cave when Satan came towards them and hid himself between them and the cave under the form of two ravenous lions 3 days without food. It came towards Adam and Hua as if to break them in pieces and devour them. Then Adam and Hua cried and prayed Elohim to deliver them from their paws. Then the word of Elohim came to them and drove away the lions from them. And Elohim said to Adam, O Adam, what do you seek on the western border, and why have you left of your own accord the eastern border, in which was your living place? Now then, turn back to your cave and remain in it, so that Satan will not deceive you or work for his purpose over you, For in this western border, O Adam, there will go from you a descendant that shall replenish it, and that will defile themselves with their sins, and with their yielding to the commands of Satan, and by following his works. Therefore will I bring over them the waters of the flood and overwhelm them all, but I will deliver what is left of the righteous among them, and I will bring them to a distant land, and the land in which you live now shall remain desolate and without one inhabitant in it. After Elohim had thus spoken to them, they went back to the cave of treasures, but their flesh was dried up, and they were weak from fasting and praying, and from the sorrow they felt for having trespassed against Elohim.
Do you see the nuggets we keep getting here? Okay, so now he's telling Adam, you've got to remain on the western side. This is where your descendants are going to come from. This is where they're going to come from, and they're going to all break my commandments. We're going to break it, and we did. Because we're fleshly and we're sinful. And so, just a second. He's saying, I'm going to have to bring a flood, and I'm going to have to wipe them out, overwhelm them. But I will deliver what is left of the righteous among them, and I will bring them to a distant land. So here's a glimpse of the flood. Yes, Jerome.
There she, Genesis 5:3. And Adam lived 130 years and brought forth a son in his likeness, in his own likeness, after his image, and he called his name Seth.
Okay.
He didn't say how old.
I'm pretty sure that this is his earthly age after he came out of the garden. I would assume.
Out of the garden? Or out of the cave?
Out of the garden.
And all the days of Adam were 930 years.
So it's 70 years short of a day. This says it was 970 years. I'll get
so
to that.
They leave the western border, they leave the eastern border, they go to the western border, then he tells them to turn back, and then he's saying to stay in the western border to have children. Because he tells them to go back to the kid. The kid was in the eastern border,
Oh, maybe he's telling us that from the western borders where his descendants will eventually one day leave from. So, but he's telling Adam to go back to the eastern border. But his descendants will leave from the western border. We need to look into that, Jean. I mean, that's what this is all about, is checking this against canonized scripture. That's what you're doing right now. I see it on your face. Good. What?
So what?
You sleep.
Okay, are you counting their age from when they left the cave or from when they were...
No, I'm talking about when they left the Garden of Eden. At that point, I think it was 150 years. I don't know why, but the cave is not going to determine their age.
Okay, when they left the garden, they were...
The garden. They were 500 years old. They had been in the garden for 500 years. But I think that it's talking about 150 years from the date that they... landed on earth. Okay. Does anybody have any other questions?
Okay, it talks about them fasting.
Yes. They had gone to the rivers and fasted. Adam had put Hua in one place, and then he went down and went to another place. And Hasatan came, and after I think it was 30 days he had fasted, or 38 days, Hasatan was able to deceive Hua and bring her out of the water. Remember, she went.
That's what he does after fast.
Well, they didn't finish their fast. They were going to fast for 40 days.
Where did they learn to fast?
They've never eaten.
So they're calling that a fast.
Well, they've not eaten. Period.
Right.
Yeah. So they're fasting and praying because they're not eating, but they haven't eaten anything. So they're in their 50-something days and they haven't eaten. I don't think they eat until like they're 80 days old.
They're babies.
They are babies. They have to eat baby food.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but their flesh is dried up and they were weak from fasting and praying because they haven't eaten. I mean, since they've come out of the garden, nothing has passed their... Have they even drank? Did they drink? I can't remember if they drank or not. Oh, he wouldn't drink. He said, no, we can't drink this. We need the water from the garden, remember? So he wouldn't drink the water from the earth. Okay, 54, Adam and Hua go exploring, I guess again.
Mm-hmm.
Then Adam and Hua stood up in the cave and prayed the whole of that night until the morning dawned. And when the sun was risen, they both went out of the cave. Their heads were wandering from heaviness and sorrow, and they didn't know where they were going. Now, they just took a stroll to the western side of the garden. And y'all was like, why'd you come over here? Go back to the eastern side. What are you doing over here, right? Okay, now they've come back out of the cave and they're like, let's go exploring the border again. We don't know what's out there. Have they asked y'all about it? No, they haven't. And they walked in that condition to the southern border of the garden and they began to go up. They're not being very observant to his commandments, are they? They walked in that condition to the southern border of the garden, and they began to go up that border until they came to the eastern border, beyond which there was no more land. And the cherub who guarded the garden was standing at the western gate and guarding it against Adam and Hua, lest they should suddenly come into the garden. And the cherub turned around as if to put them to death, according to the commandment Elohim had given him. When Adam and Hua came to the eastern border of the garden, thinking in their hearts that the cherub was not watching, as they were standing by the gate, as if wishing to go in, suddenly came the cherub with a flashing sword of fire in his hand. And when he saw them, he went forth to kill them, for he was afraid that Elohim would destroy him if they went into the garden without his order. You know, that reminds me of, you know, it says that there are stars that are in captivity because they've disobeyed Yah's orders, right? Those would be angels. Mm-hmm. Okay, so he was afraid that he would be completely destroyed. And the sword of the cherub seemed to shoot flames a distance away from it. But when he raised it over Adam and Hua, the flame of the sword did not flash forth. Therefore, the cherub thought that Elohim was favorable to them and was bringing them back into the garden. And the cherub stood wondering. He would not go up to heaven to determine Elohim's order regarding their getting into the garden. He therefore continued to stand by them, unable as he was to part from them. So he was afraid if he left the garden gate, they're going to run in, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, who's blocking the gate from them? So he's just kind of standing there waiting for his orders. For he was afraid that if they should enter the gate without permission, Elohim would destroy him. When Adam and Hua saw the cherub, you know, guys, listen, what does it say? If even the cherub, and this is a very strong angel, if he is afraid that Yahweh will destroy him for disobedience, why would we think we're any different? I mean, the fear of Yah should be in all of us, right? When Adam and Hua saw the cherub coming towards them with a flaming sword in a fire in his hand, they fell on their faces from fear and were as dead. And at that time, the heavens and the earth shook, and another cherubim came down from heaven to the cherub who guarded the garden and saw him amazed and silent. Then again, other angels came down close to the place where Adam and Hua were. They were divided between joy and sorrow. They were glad because they thought that Elohim was favorable to Adam and wished him to return to the garden. They missed him. He was in the image of Yah, and they missed him. They were very sorrowful when he was escorted out of the garden. And they wished to restore him to the gladness he once enjoyed, but they sorrowed over Adam because he was fallen like a dead man, he and Hua. And they said in their thoughts, Adam has not died in this place, but Elohim has put him to death for his having come to this place and wishing to get into the garden without his permission. They were told not to go to the garden in this direction. I mean, they were told how many times, don't go there. And they did it. The conflict between Elohim and Satan, and this is the battle in the heavens that we read about, where the angels were cast down. That's what you're fixing to read, or hear. Then came the word of Elohim to Adam and Hua, and raised them from their dead state, saying to them, why did you come up here? Did you intend to go into the garden from which I brought you out? It cannot be today, but only when the covenant I have made with you is fulfilled. It's like, how many times does he have to tell them, right? They're just like little children. How long till we get there, Mom? How long? 5 minutes. Mom, how long before we get there? 2 minutes. I mean, they just keep, he's like, how long before we can come in now? Oh, let's see, 5,495 years. There. Don't ask again. Then Adam, when he heard the word of Elohim and the fluttering of the angels, whom he did not see, but only heard the sound of them with his ears, he and Hua cried. And they said to the angels, O Ruachah, which are spirits, who wait on Elohim, look at me and at my being unable to see you. For when I was in my former bright nature, then I could see you. I sang praises as you do, and my heart was far above you. But now that I have transgressed, that bright nature is gone from me, and I have come to this miserable state. So now I have come to this, that I cannot see you, and you do not serve me like you used to, for I have become animal flesh. Yet now, O angels of Elohim, ask Elohim with me to restore me to that wherein I was formerly, to rescue me from this misery, and to remove from me the sentence of death he passed on me for having transgressed against him. Then when the angels heard these words, they all grieved over him and cursed Satan who had misled Adam until he came from the garden to misery, from life to death, from peace to trouble, and from gladness to a strange land. Then the angels said to Adam, you obeyed Satan and ignored the word of Elohim who created you, and you believed that Satan would fulfill all that he promised you. But now, O Adam, we make known to you what came over us through him before his fall from heaven. He gathered together his host, and he deceived them, promising them a great kingdom, a divine nature, and other promises he made to them. His host believed that his word was true, so they yielded to him, and they renounced the glory of Elohim. They did exactly what Adam and Hua did. Let go of everything that Yah had given them for the lies that HaSatan was promising them. We do the same thing, guys. You know? He then sent for us according.
So they didn't, these angels didn't leave at the same time. HaSatan was kicked out of heaven.
Well, these are the good angels. This is the battle between the good and the bad. So these are the good ones, and this is what the angel is telling them, is that this is what the angel said to Adam. You obeyed Satan and ignored the word of Elohim who created you, and you believed that Satan would fulfill all he promised you. But now, O Adam, we will make known to you what came over us through him before his fall from heaven. He gathered together his host and deceived them, promising to give them a great kingdom, a divine nature, and other promises he made to them. His host believed that his word was true, so they yielded to him, and they renounced the glory of Elohim. He then sent for us according to the orders in which we were to come under his command and to accept his vain promise, but we would not, and we did not take his advice. Then after he had fought with Elohim and had dealt forwardly with him, he gathered together his host and made war with us. And if it had not been for Elohim's strength that was with us, we could not have prevailed against him to hurl him from heaven. But when he fell from amongst us, it was a great joy in heaven because of his going down from us. For if he had remained in heaven, nothing, not even one angel would have remained in it. But Elohim in his mercy drove him from amongst us to this dark earth, for he has become darkness itself and a worker of unrighteousness. And he has continued, O Adam, to make war against you until he tricked you and made you come out of the garden to this strange land where all these trials have come to you. And death, which Elohim brought to him, he has also brought to you, O Adam, because you obeyed him and trespassed against Elohim. Then all the angels rejoiced and praised Elohim and asked him not to destroy Adam for this time, for his having sought to enter the garden, but to bear with him until the fulfillment of the promise, to help him in this world until he was free from the hands of Satan. So look at Revelation 12:7. And there came to be fighting in the heaven. Michael and his messengers fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his messengers fought, but they were not strong enough. nor was a place found for them in the heaven any longer. And the great dragon was thrown out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who leads all the world astray. He was thrown to the earth, and his messengers were thrown out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in the heaven, now have come the deliverance and the power and the reign of our Elohim and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers, who accused them before our Elohim day and night, has been thrown down. And they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their witness. They did not love their lives to the death. And look at Psalms 89:44. What's interesting is Revelation is almost an exact replica of what we're just reading in the first book of Adam and Hua. Okay, verse 44. You have brought to an end his splendor and have hurled his throne to the ground. You have shortened the days of his youth and you have covered him with shame, Selah. And he is talking about Hasatan. Look at Luke 10:18. Still got people awake that are still moving about in the books. And this is Yahusha. And he said to them, I saw Satan falling out of the heaven as lightning. And see, I have given you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over the power of the enemy, and none at all shall hurt you. So Yahusha himself saw Hasatan being cast out, and he was cast to here, to the earth. And this is where he is. He will make war on us till the end of time. Why?
Because he hates us because we're Yah's children.
We're Yah's children. We're made in the image of Yah. And Yah has kept covenant with us. Now, he didn't have a covenant with Satan.
And he thinks he can hurt Yahuwah by doing this to us. So it turns away from Yahuwah.
Yes. He thinks that he will be king. Mm-hmm. If he can defeat everyone, he thinks he will be king.
He's very stupid.
He is.
He really is.
Uh-huh.
Can you read?
I was looking to see if there's something here for us. That's good, but it was really talking about the messengers. So guys, we need to investigate. I think, Jerome, are you still back there investigating? Why not? Okay, 130. I thought it was 150. Okay. Okay. So, I believe there are other writings that might can substantiate everything, but so there's a question right there. We were able to answer the question on the sheepskins after the fall. Animals were eating animals, but that is a question on the number of years old that he was. But everything else seems to line up with scripture pretty well. Don't y'all think?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody got questions? Anybody got some concerns? You know what's interesting is that in the last part here, the angels rejoiced and praised Elohim and they interceded. They asked Yah not to destroy Adam. They interceded for Adam, for his life. I thought that was really interesting. They loved him.
Yeah, well, he was in the image of God.
Yes, they interceded.
He was in the image
of Yah.
Yeah, that's, they respected that.
Well, we'll see later, and this is one reason that supposedly Hasatan, and I believe it actually comes in 57, next week is going to get really pretty cool. But I believe in 57 is where we get to the place where when Yah made Adam and he made him his image, he made the messengers bow to Adam. As
that's what it says in Hebrews.
Mm-hmm.
Can you read it?
Yes, is it Hebrews? Yeah, I was going to read that part. Yeah, go ahead.
For it is not to messengers that he has subjected the world to come concerning which we speak, but somehow one has witnessed, saying, what is man that you remember him, or the son of man that you look after him? You have made him a little lower than Elohim. You have crowned him with esteem and respect and set him over the works of your hands. You have put all in subjection under him.
And we will judge the messengers, the angels.
That's chapter 2, starting with verse 5. But we do see him who is made for a little while lower than the messengers. Yahusha, so I don't know.
So in the book of the Asher, it says he was also 130.
Okay, so the question is, are they taking into account the years
in the garden,
in the garden, or out of the garden?
I think they're taking
account of
out of the garden.
Once
you're
born, I mean, created,
okay, that would be
out of the garden.
Oh, that's right.
Not in their light, not in their
in their light, in their body of light.
But after.
I have confused though, because like he breathed. Life into his being, so at that time he was creating.
It was his spirit. And we talked about that being his spirit, the spirit man.
They had a different body in the garden.
Right. It was a spiritual. I think it was a spiritual being at that time.
Well, that's what he says. When I was in my nature of light.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nowhere else does it say Adam was the nature of light.
He says, for when I was in my former bright nature, and so when Moshe spent time with Yah, he also became a bright nature. His face shone.
But does Torah, Genesis tell you that there were beings of light that they had?
Mm-mm.
They were spiritual, and then when they were kicked out of the garden, then
well, it doesn't talk about any of this, because Genesis was written by Moshe. And this book was supposedly written by Seth.
Even the book of Yahusha.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. There's a big question. We'll have to see if it's anywhere else. I mean, because there are a lot of books out there that we have not read.
I'm looking into the Septuagint and then the Dead Sea Scrolls.
They should be pretty much in line.
Genesis 1:26 says, and Elohim said, let us make man in our image. What Yahuwah is spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He still has an image.
No, his image is spirit. Yahuwah's image is spirit. It's not flesh.
But then when they see him, he's also dressed as a warrior. His battle brigade.
Who?
You know what, Charles?
Isn't that Yahuwah?
Uh-huh.
So I think it does say here in our image, and he says he's spirit.
Mm-hmm. And light.
According to our likeness. Mm-hmm. So while it appears that while he was in the garden, he was light, which was spirit. We're to have to be the light of the world. We're to be spiritual.
We didn't get the flesh nature until we came to the earth.
They were light. Yeah, that's why we made it.
Mm-hmm.
But ain't the garden a key inside Earth?
It is on Earth, but it was not Earth. They were not earthly at that time. They were light, angelic spirits, like the angels. And so that's what Yah said. He said, when you transgress the law, I gave you skin, animal bodies.
That's
and so animal bodies. Okay, and this is the difference between the angelic and the animal bodies. Angelic bodies don't have to have an outhouse or a bathroom. There's no need for it.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I think I heard it.
So
newspaper, Tom.
It is somewhere. I think it's in Romans.
Valerie, I'm sorry, I left you.
He tells us to walk in the Spirit. I mean, we're supposed to be spiritual. I mean, even in the flesh, we're supposed to. The Ruach HaKodesh is supposed to rule in us.
Let me ask you a question. Do y'all want to go on through 56 and 57, or y'all want to stop here? I haven't prepared 56 and 57, but we can.
Well, that's right. We can
prepare. Well, we should know more about this flesh.
Flesh?
Flesh thing.
Flesh. The flesh?
Flesh.
Well,
it's the flesh.
Yeah, we were clothed with flesh after the fall. That's what y'all, that's what y'all clothed Adam and Eve with, was flesh. The whole story, yeah.
We were like him. They were like him. And he is spirit. He doesn't have flesh.
It doesn't say they were clothed in skins, like animal skins.
They became clothed in animal skins.
I thought it said
animal. But no.
It doesn't say.
Well, no,
it
does.
The skins, because the animal skins
are
getting hot and cold.
It does say that y'all clothed them in a lamb's skin. Okay, but guys, what we have to remember is that in the books, like Genesis, it's a compressed book.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't expect to get the fullness of the story in a compressed book. So the fullness of the story of Adam and Eve, listen, I've always wondered, hey, if I were Adam and Hua and I was being escorted out of the garden, the perfect place where you have everything you could ever possibly want, except to be God, who in their right mind would come up against Yah and even chance? Of course, they had no idea what the punishment was either. They had no way of knowing because they lived in an idyllic world.
Well, it says in 3 Genesis, and the man called 29 so, and Yahuwah Elohim made coats of skin for the man and his wife and dressed them.
Okay, so that is the sheepskins that he sent the angel to make. But when they came out of the garden in the first book of Adam and Eve, he gave them flesh skins.
That
their
so,
body skins. That's right, and
that's why they were ashamed.
It's the spirit that gives you
station
of
your disability.
I mean, compare it with Yeshua.
Being dropped down in the spirit of the flesh.
Right.
And that's what they were ashamed of.
Hey, live streamers, you're joining in on our discussion here, so we flip this around.
Compare it with Yeshua. The word made flesh, and he walked until the end of his ministry, for a year.
And then was in the
tomb for 3 days and three nights, just like they were flesh put on them, and directly here they
the stone covered
under the. I mean, it's all like a.
Where was he? Where was Yeshua alive after he buried and came back? Remember, he was as a light.
Mm-hmm.
What was that?
He shone as a light.
Right. So he'd been to heaven. He had discarded his flesh.
Mm-hmm.
So. Skin.
Flesh is not good.
Grab it. Touch everything and I turn a different color. I do.
You're going to be like your car.
Yeah.
Turn the car.
She looked
pink when she turned the corner. It, yes.
Could they have had babies if they didn't have no skin?
I don't know. Wait. Yahusha tells us that when we are in heaven, that there will be no marriage, and there won't be sex in heaven.
So basically, when it was saying you will bring forth children in pain, it was said after?
Yes.
Because they wasn't having children.
Yeah, that was when they became, that is absolutely correct.
Right, that's all I was wondering.
And man, did he keep that promise, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Tiff knows, she's got children. Okay, any other questions? Charles?
Yeah,
What a face. So do any of our, hi, Shamuan. Does anybody else have any questions on live stream? Do y'all want to do 56 and 57?
Next week.
Next week? Okay. Okay. So we will continue. Next week it's going to get really, really, really good. So Hebrews 2:5 is where you found that on the angels.
Uh-huh.
And you know, you can look at Hebrews 1, and Hebrews 1 talks all about the messengers.
Yes.
As well. Yeah. Hebrews 1, let's see, Hebrews 1, 1 through 5, and Hebrews 1, 13 through 14 are all about the messengers and the differences there.
2, 5.
And 1, 13 through 14, and 1, 1 through 5. So concludes another day with Adam and Hua. Adam and Eve.
He's bringing, his last days, he's bringing out information for us. We say it until the last days, we know that.
You know, guys, and that does bring us to a good point. In Ezra, and I believe the fourth book of Ezra, and I believe it's the 10th chapter. Y'all know what I'm talking about in here, right? Act like you do. Come on, y'all act like you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, I knew y'all did. I believe it was. The, oh, here we go. It's actually in chapter 14 of the fourth book of Ezra, and I'm on page 429. Do you have the new one or the old one? The old one?
The old one.
Old one?
1411 or 1412.
Okay, so guys, what happened when Babylon came in and destroyed all the scrolls and the writings, and what happened then? They had no Torah. They had no scriptures. And this is what Ezra told. It actually starts over here on in 14:19 or 20. Behold, Yahuwah, I will go as you have commanded me, and reprove the people which are present. But they that shall be born afterward, who shall admonish them? Thus the world is set in darkness, and they that dwell therein are without light. For your Torah is burnt. They have been burnt. Therefore, no man knows the things that are done of you, or the work that shall be done. But if I have found grace before you, send the Ruach HaKodesh into me, the Holy Spirit, and I shall write all that has been done in the world since the beginning, which were written in your Torah, that men may find your path in that which they will live in the latter days, and they will live. And what Yah did is he told Ezra, go, gather these five men, come together, and then if you look over towards the end of chapter 14, in verse 42, El Elyon gave understanding unto the five men, and they wrote the wonderful visions of the night that were told, which they knew not. And they sat 40 days, and they wrote in the day, and at night they ate. As for me, I spoke in the day, and I withheld not my tongue at night. And in 40 days, they wrote 94 sifarim, 94 books. How many books are in our canonized scripture? 66. And so there's 94 from 66. What's that? 26 extra book. 26 extra books. And it came to pass when the 40 days were filled that El Elyon spoke, saying, the first that you have written, publish openly, that the worthy and the unworthy may read it. Okay, so guys, back then there wasn't a First and Second Kings. There wasn't a First and Second Chronicles. So rather than the number of Old Testament books, there were actually 24. Okay? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. What is the Torah destroyed?
In Babylon, it was also in, what was that, 536 B.C.? First Temple.
Mm-hmm.
whenever we wrote these, but the 24 you have written, publish openly, that the worthy and unworthy may read it, but keep the 70 last, that you may deliver them only to such that be the wise among the people. So the 70 are being revealed now. But I'm going to tell you something. Jubilees was in the original canonized scripture. It was there. So Jubilees has been now uncovered, and we're starting to read it again. The fourth book of Ezra was in the original canonized scripture. So a lot of the books that we're reading right now were originally in there. They were taken out in the 1600s and the 1700s. Who did that? Who would have done that? Who?
70.
They're being revealed right now. Dead Sea Scrolls are being revealed.
Are you saying that those Jubilees in Ezra were in the 70 or additions to the 70?
They were in the original canonized scripture. They were in the original
Torah. So they weren't in that 70 that's been?
No.
Okay. So it's some of those like Ecclesiasticus and those. Right?
Charles, do you remember Ecclesiasticus, if it was in the original, or Jerome, do you remember?
I do know it was in the Septuagint.
Okay, then it was.
I think it is in the.
Okay, so it was in the original.
It's very good.
So really, you could look at the Ethiopic Bible, and that's pretty much the originals. And then a lot of those have been taken out and removed. But they're back. Enoch was never meant to be included, but you've got like the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. Published in the canonized scripture.
Yah saved it for the last days.
Enoch. Yah said that it was not to be put in the book. But you got the Testament of Moses. You got the Apocalypse of Moses. You've got, that's Genesis.
That's the New
These are in Beersheet in the beginning. Some of the books that have been found in the Dead Sea Scrolls and Qumran. But that's what a lot of these books are. And this is a Stephen Pidgeon at Zephyr. This is part of his series. I've got five of these books. So there are a lot of books out there. Yes, sir.
On the Battle Battle is Exodus 15:3.
You can take that if you give it back to me.
About the what?
When they're leaving, they're crossing the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
So God is my strength and song. We have to become a deliverance. He is my God, and I praise him. It was he, my father, and I exalt him. Yahuwah is the man of battle. Yahuwah is my name. It's his name, excuse me. And then it says he has cast down chariots and longer to sea, and his chosen officers are grounded to the sea of reeds. Who actually said the sea of reeds?
Okay, so wait, where are you going with that? Because you lost me.
Well, remember when I told you that when they saw him like in battle armor?
Uh-huh.
I know his word, something where he has the name or something.
That's in Revelation.
Yeah, I don't understand where he has the word.
No, that's in Revelation.
Okay, so, live streamers, what time is it, girls and boys?
I don't know.
4:30. Okay. Live streamers, we want to thank you so much for joining us for this adventure. As you can tell, it's an adventure for us all through the book, the first book of Adam and Eve. And guys, listen, if you've got questions, please send them to us, because as you can tell, we've got questions as well. And some of them, we're still searching for answers. But as far as I'm concerned, this is so close to our canonized scripture that I don't see it butting heads with it. Does anyone else?
I do.
Okay, Jerome does. Okay, we've got two out of.
Elizabeth's in, I'm sorry.
And we've got three that are not paying attention. It falls in line close enough. It does feel like a fill-in.
I see Genesis as like a book.
I agree. So, Jerome, besides the years there, what else do you have an issue with?
That they were not finished until they got kicked out of the garden.
Okay.
I think they were both spiritual workers. Just like our Messiah, they were 100% spiritual, 100% flesh.
You can't compare.
He was flesh on earth, but he wasn't flesh prior to coming to earth.
His creation.
No, he doesn't. It doesn't say that. Because the flesh, this fleshly skin, is considered animal, and animal is not spiritual.
And the reason animal, why they became flesh and animal is because they became more combat when they sinned. It's the same reason why you don't eat pork, because it makes you more animal.
Don't eat pork.
It's about the energy. That's why they say you are what you eat. And that's why the demons were able to be cast into a swine. They were the same energetic frequency.
Oh, that is a really good point. See, guys, we have so much fun here. So we're fixing a tar and feather, Jerome. Yeah, next time you'll see him, he's going to have... He was talking about Quetzalcoatl. He's going to look like Quetzalcoatl. I'm kidding. You guys, listen. We're cutting out the food next time. We're not eating.
We're going to be fasting next Shabbat. 40 days and 40 nights.
You cannot fast on Shabbat.
What about a 40-day, 40-night fast?
You can't fast on Shabbat. That's against the
Moses
commandments.
Did
we look out on the 40 days, 40 nights? Huh? We can't fast 40 days, 40 nights.
We would have to cheat on Shabbat.
Show me a person who actually fasts for 40 days.
I've had someone that fasted, but it was a water fast. I've had two people that did it. So, listen, guys, as you can tell, the debates are just starting. We've got a fight over here. We've got an argument over there. Come join us. It's a lot of fun. We love you. We love you. We bless you. And, Father, we just thank you. Thank you for all these wise minds that we have in this class. We love you so much, y'all. You've got such a good sense of humor. Mm-hmm. And Father, bless each one as they go home today. Mm-hmm. Father, and we bless your name. In the precious name of Yahusha, we pray these things. Amen. Mm-hmm. And amen. Mm-hmm. Shabbat shalom. It's still Shabbat shalom.
Did you say you have